In 1961, Berlin was divided by a wall.
People couldn't understand that this was going to be a permanent division of their city, and they really wouldn't be able to walk across the street to see their mother anymore.
The East Germans are razing homes and buildings along the border.
The wall would become the most enduring symbol of the Cold War.
Civilized world cried shame when East German guards shot a fleeing teenager and then left him to die.
People were killed trying to get across from communist East Berlin to the West. After 28 years...
This is a historic night.
The wall came down. The last days of the Second World War saw the Allied forces closing in on Germany. The Red Army attacked from the east. The American, British and French forces from the west. Berlin was completely surrounded by the Soviet army. Once the heart of the Third Reich, Berlin was decimated. The war in Europe ended with the raising of the red flag on Germany's parliament building, the Reichstag, in the center of the city. The defeated Germany was divided into four parts by the victorious powers, each one being ruled by their armed forces. The American, British and French sectors became West Germany. The Soviet zone, East Germany. 90 miles within the East German territory was Berlin. Before the wall was built, Berlin was divided into four sectors, three occupied by the Western troops, won by the Soviets. Christopher Hilton is a British author who has studied the impact of the wall since first seeing it as a tourist in 1970. He regularly returns to Berlin to continue his research into this extraordinary episode in history.
Berlin remained, until 1961, very much a single city, although divided in theoretical lines, only theoretical lines, with the Soviets and the East Germans running one part and the West running the other. The underground system was connected, the bus system was connected, the phone system was connected, the sewerage system was connected, the tram lines were connected. It was just one city, and it was unthinkable it could be divided. West Berlin was heavily subsidized by the West and prosperous. East Germany had to pay war reparations to the Soviets and was therefore very poor. So the two standards of living were wildly different on either side of the same street. And as a consequence, the East Germans began to just walk across and emigrate to the West, which wanted skilled East German workers. And East Germany began to hemorrhage at the rate of a small town a year. Well, if you've only got 19 million to start with, you know where that the logic of that's going to go. It's going to go to oblivion.
The East German government responded on Sunday, August the 13th, 1961, by deploying troops to stand shoulder to shoulder and divide the city, preventing anyone from crossing over.
People couldn't understand that this was going to be a permanent division of their city, and they really wouldn't be able to walk across the street to see their mother anymore.
In the early days, the wall was primarily a barrier constructed from barbed wire, which divided the city in two. Those who were brave and bold enough, though, did still escape. From his Berlin home, Hagen Koch has put together a fascinating archive all about the wall. It gives a detailed insight into the East German regime's attitude to the barrier. Hagen recalls how, as a young man, he was ordered to survey the new border installations.
I was 21 years old and in the border guards. On the 15th of August, I went through the city with a map, recording everything. In the afternoon, I reached Checkpoint Charlie. On the western side, people were protesting, throwing stones and bottles. So I was ordered to paint a very thick white line across the road at Checkpoint Charlie to indicate to the Westerners, you can go this far, but not further. At the time, I believed the wall would be a good thing and prevent my country, East Germany, being drawn into World War III.
In August 1961, in an attempt to stop East Berliners from migrating to the West, the East German government erected a barbed wire barrier. A barrier that would eventually become a wall.
Despite these hazards, smoke and tear gas bombs, sometimes boomerang on the East.
As Berliners realized their city had been severed overnight, violence erupted. In Bernauer Strasse, there was a building where people could walk into their front doors from the east, then jump out of their windows into the west.
East Berliners who have apartments facing the border take the long chance when they get orders to leave their homes for the interior. While an East German guard attempts to yank her back to prison, West Berliners pull her to a fire net and freedom. Of danger, from fourth and fifth floor windows, from any hatchway open to escape, they flee. This woman drops into a net held by alerted firemen, and then, as a tense crowd watches, she is followed by her husband. But first, he throws out a few prized possessions. Determined to protect their people from such temptations, the East Germans are razing homes and buildings along the border.
The windows in Bernauer Strasse were quickly bricked up, and not long after, the whole building was demolished. The first wall was only about 2 meters high. Watchtowers soon appeared in East Berlin to monitor every move near the barrier. Soon, even students were taking their chances to escape.
When the wall was built, I was nearly 17 years old. It was a big surprise, a nightmare for me, when I switched on the West Berlin radio on Sunday, 13th of August, to listen to the news, and I heard this terrible announcement. From that day on, I had only one thought, and that was the thought of escaping.
Falco and a friend carefully chose the time and place and began to make their way towards the wall. A lone border guard walked by so close, the boys could easily have been spotted. A single guard, however, could afford to turn a blind eye. Had he been with another guard, the boys may not have been so lucky. After 20 minutes, Falco and his friend had made it to the fence. About 8 meters away was the 2-meter-high wall. Falco helped his friend over, then jumped down into the safety of West Berlin.
As you might expect, I had a great sense of relief and happiness. When we reported to a West Berlin police station, I was handed a Beta Stuyvesant, a cigarette brand which was advertised at the time with the slogan, "The smell of the great free world." Ironically, it was very fitting.
The wall was clearly not impregnable, and the East German authorities responded ruthlessly.
In diesen Analysen wird festgestellt,
these documents show how every single escape attempt was closely analyzed. It was found that escapes were increasing, so it was decided that weapons must be used to prevent them. And so we started shooting at escapees. And this is a report recording weapons fired during escape attempts between the 13th and the 31st of August. It records that there are three warning shots, one targeted shot, and the result is one dead person, Günter Litvin. He tried to escape at a canal basin. Here is the railroad bridge. This is where the guards were stationed. This is Litvin's escape route, and from about 40 yards away, the lethal shots were fired.
Günter Litvin did not know the guards had been ordered to shoot, and he became the first escapee to be shot trying to get to West Berlin, just on the other side of the canal.
The East German government didn't tell us that my brother had been killed. We saw it on West German TV. They announced that the first person had been shot at the wall and that his name was Günter Litvin. The next day, I went to the coroner's office to see if what had been reported on West German TV was true. They refused to let me see my brother to identify him.
Man zeigte mir den Bruder nicht, um ihn zu identifizieren, sondern sagte noch, wenn ihr sagt.
They insisted the coffin would have to remain sealed for the funeral. At his funeral, at the end of August, I managed to get into the basement of the little chapel where they kept the bodies and broke the coffin open with a crowbar. I wanted to see if my brother had been shot so badly that he was unrecognizable. My brother was in his coffin with a band-aid on his chin where the bullet had come out and a wound in his neck. I put some small flowers in his hands and closed the coffin. Then the funeral took place.
Günter Litvin's death was not widely publicized. But a few months later, another fatal shooting would occur in the full glare of worldwide publicity. The victim was a teenager named Peter Fechter.
There was what I believe was a defining moment when two young men from the East tried to get across quite near Checkpoint Charlie in 1962. One got across and the other was shot down, a young man called Peter Fechter, against the wall and was left to bleed to death.
The civilized world cried shame when East German guards shot a fleeing teenager and then left him to die. They removed his body, but they will never remove him as a symbol to the angered Germans. They vented their wrath on buses carrying Russian guards to a Soviet war memorial and turned to the West Berlin Freedom Bell to voice their unity as a people.
Because it was so near to Checkpoint Charlie, West Berlin policemen and American soldiers came along. Of course, they were not allowed to go into the East. They were not allowed to climb over the wall. So what they tried to do was drop first aid kits over to him as he lay there. The East Berlin border guard were frightened to go near Fechter in case the West Berliners started to shoot at them. So he was left until the East German army could be summoned, and that took 30 or 40 minutes. He kept murmuring, "Why don't you help me? Why don't you help me?" And nobody could. And this was the moment where everybody knew the truth about the war. They really would shoot to kill. And that changed everything.
East Germany's leader, Walter Ulbricht, knew that the killing of Peter Fechter could not be covered up. So Ulbricht decided to make something of it.
Mit dem Tod von Peter Fechter.
With the death of Peter Fechter, a name and a face can be put to the victims of the war. Fechter's death is heard about worldwide. This makes its mark on the border guards. So in the fall of 1962, the East German leader, Walter Ulbricht, presents this flag of honor to the 33rd Border Regiment to commend them for the death of Peter Fechter.
Auch der Tod von Peter Fechter richtig ist, dass die Grenzsoldaten keine Skrupel haben.
To counter the guards' uneasiness, Ulbricht has the commemorative flag made with his own portrait on it.
Auf der sein eigenes Porträt drauf ist.
This was his way of indoctrinating the guards to continue using their weapons to stop escapees.
Damit sie mit ihrer Waffe weiter an dieser Grenze Gebrauch machen, um Fluchten zu verhindern.
Roland Eggersdorfer was a border guard, patrolling the wall from a watchtower like this one. He was just 19 years old.
Der Kampfauftrag hieß ja, Grenzverletzer festzunehmen.
The combat mission was either to arrest or destroy. Everyone was aware of that at all times. So what would one have done? Looking back, I would have shot. This is how we were educated. We were taught that those wanting to escape were all criminals. The greatest fear, whenever we went back to the barracks after duty, we said, thank God, I didn't have to shoot. Or thank God, no special incidents in my section. The border guards didn't want to have to shoot. The guards started thinking, what else can I build into this wall? Alarms, telephone installations, public address systems. All these ideas were developed by the guards themselves, and their ideas were presented to the Minister for National Defense. He looked at them and said, good, we can do that. Or, no good, we can't do that.
The wall rapidly evolved. Many buildings close to it were demolished, and a hinterland fence about 46 meters behind was built to fortify it. The no man's land between the wall and the fence became known as the Death Strip. The few openings in the wall allowed a small number of people and cars to cross between the two halves of the city. One of the crossing points into the American sector was known as Checkpoint Charlie. Today, the crossing point is a museum dedicated to the history of the wall. One of the exhibits is the original white line painted by Hagen Koch that divided East and West Berlin. Also on display are some of the devices used to escape.
As the wall became more sophisticated, more human ingenuity was needed to get across it. Some escapers converted an Isetta, an Italian bubble car, by tinkering with the engine, tinkering with the fuel tank to make it much smaller, just enough to get a human being concealed in it. Because it was so small and so cramped, the East German border guards waved it through because it was clearly impossible to hide a human being in it. And they were wrong because it was used several times.
To avoid the border guards altogether, groups of students started tunneling under the Death Strip. One of the students involved was Hasso Herschel.
It is quite difficult to do, because the tunnel requires a certain depth. It has to go under building foundations and below the sewer system, 12 to 18 feet deep. You could only do that with the help of a lot of people. Around 48 worked on our tunnel. There was a corps of about 8 to 12, but we always had the support of other students.
Tunneling was such an ambitious venture that some people specialized purely in raising money. Wolfgang Cockrow was a fundraiser who even had the backing of the West German government.
I could help with 30,000 marks. And this money I get from the Ministry of Family and Refugee. Then we need money for technical things, for electric lines. They need gas masks, they need police blue flashlights, walkie-talkies, and so on. The tunnel was 3 feet high and 2 feet wide. 10 students live there in the tunnel for 1 week or 10 days, sleeping there, eating there, working there.
Lookouts were posted, and the comings and goings of tunnelers minimized to avoid arousing suspicion.
The tunnel was open for 2 nights, and at least 57 people came through the tunnel. And so the name Tunnel 57.
All the tunnels under the wall were dug from West Berlin to the east, because it would have been impossible to keep the tunneling secret in the heavily patrolled border areas of East Berlin. Once the initial tunnel had been channeled, it was angled upwards so that the soil dug could fall naturally downhill. Hasso Herschel worked on Tunnel 29.
We had started digging in the west in the premises of an old empty factory. The basements were big and were no longer being used. There was only one entrance. The owner handed us the keys and said, "Go ahead, guys, I know nothing."
Ich weiß von nichts.
When we started the tunnel, we ran into various small difficulties with getting rid of the debris as well as with the air supply. But the further we got, the worse it became. The problems quadrupled. In order to have sufficient air, we bought a pump and sucked in fresh air from the outside through stovepipes. Each pipe was about 3 feet long, and we put them together, one to another, as we got further.
Running for more than 122 meters, it was vital the tunnel had a steady supply of oxygen. The pumps described by Hasso Herschel were financed by the American broadcaster NBC Television in return for the film rights. On more than one occasion, the tunnelers hit water mains and flooded the tunnel. Work would have to be halted while the tunnel was pumped and left to dry out again. As well as practical difficulties, there was the ever-present threat of discovery by the border guards.
We knew they had these small tear gas candles. They would tie about 40 together and throw them in. Bundled together, they were like a hand grenade. If one goes off, you look stupid.
After 6 months, the tunnel broke through into the courtyard of this building. 29 people crawled through the tunnel to freedom.
The most important thing was my sister, my brother-in-law and my niece, who was a year old at that time. I had promised that I would try absolutely everything to get them across.
Once everyone had made it safely through, Tunnel 29 was sealed. But unknown to the tunnelers, the East German government was already onto them, developing technology to locate and destroy the escape routes under the wall. In 1961, Berlin was divided by a wall, but many East Berliners were desperate to escape. Increasing fortification, border guards and watchtowers had made it too dangerous overground, so East Berliners started secretly tunneling, except it was no secret to the East German government.
The interesting thing is that in Bernauer Straße at the beginning of the 1960s, there were tunnels. And these documents contain the order that a searching device for tunnels should be developed, capable of finding holes and cavities in the ground. Such a machine was never put into service. Tunneling stopped in the middle of the 1960s because the death strip was constantly being widened. So they had to dig increasingly long tunnels.
From about 1965, the wall's fortifications became more permanent. Besides the newly widened death strip, a concrete wall replaced the hinterland fence. A new 2-meter electric fence alerted guards to any attempts to break through. Anti-vehicle traps were installed, and wooden watchtowers were replaced with concrete ones, each with 360-degree views of the wall and no man's land, the death strip. For the guards to immediately access any part of the wall, a patrol road was constructed to run the entire length of the barrier. a strip of sand was laid to reveal the footprints of escapees. An anti-vehicle ditch guarded the western wall, which was heightened and topped with a piping that was hard to grip. Floodlights were installed 160 kilometers around West Berlin, sealing it off from East Germany, as well as illuminating the wall. Escape across the death strip became an impossibility. Hartmut Richter was born in East Germany in 1948.
Teachers told us, you live in the first state where workers, farmers, you know, built the state, and it's the best German state, nicht? And that I believe.
Like all schoolchildren, Hartmut was indoctrinated by the East German regime. Today, he's a tour guide, teaching schoolchildren the history of the city and of the war.
Um auch das zu verhindern, waren die Türme so konzipiert gebaut, dass man also auch jederzeit in den Himmel leuchten konnte.
Hartmut soon realized that the wall was built not to defend East Germany against the West, as his teachers told him, but to keep East Germans in.
There was a music too, nicht? I liked to hear the Beatles, the Stones, Beach Boys, and so, and we hair grow, you know.
Determined to escape, Hartmut decided to cross the border, where there was no wall. The canal between East and West Berlin. The 1 kilometer swim would take him 4 hours. He even had to climb over a submerged barrier, but managed to avoid detection.
They didn't see me, I swam to the left side of the bank, and I read, you are leaving the American sector. In German, Sie verlassen jetzt West-Berlin. I moved to the checkpoint, any meters behind. I saw a West German car. There was a lady inside, and I looked at the, and asked where. Do you know where I am in West Berlin? And they looked and, yeah, sure, you are West Berlin. It's a, yeah, your friend was very happy. So the old lady too, you know, saw me there. And, yeah.
As the years passed, West German citizens were granted visits to the East. With the growing traffic between West and East Germany, it became impractical for guards to search every car. Now a West German citizen, Hartmut began traveling to East Berlin to smuggle people out.
It was not so difficult. It wasn't easy, but it was not so difficult. It was a great thing for me, nicht to help people out there to escape.
But the authorities soon noticed that every time Hartmut visited, an East German citizen vanished. On his 31st trip, the guards were waiting. Hiding in the boot of Hartmut's car, they discovered his sister. Brother and sister were both arrested, and Hartmut was sentenced to 15 years in this Berlin prison.
The East Germans valued Western currency very, very highly, hard currency, and they discovered a very lucrative way of getting their hands on it, which was by essentially selling people who tried to escape and selling what we would call political prisoners, people who'd asked to leave East Germany, simply selling them to the West German government.
Until the ransom was paid, the East Germans kept their prisoners. In total, the West paid out for 34,000 East Germans, including $50,000 for Hartmut Richter.
They bought me free in November 1980. So I was 5 years and 7 months in jail.
The East German government continued to reiterate the message that the border guards were merely defending their fatherland and socialism.
Once a month, the soldiers had political instruction classes where we were taught specifically that the enemy was West Germany, West Berlin, that criminals lived there who were primarily engaged in trying to harm East Germany. That's what we heard all day long. This is what we were taught, and everyone believed it. It was all about the big fight. That is what everything came down to. Socialism versus capitalism.
Just a few meters away, but a world apart, other young men patrolled their side of the wall. The US Army maintained a daily wall patrol to assert their rights in Berlin, just as the Russians, the British, and the French did. The presence of communists and NATO troops just a few meters apart made Berlin a potential flashpoint throughout the Cold War. East Germany claimed the wall prevented invasion from the west, but the anti-vehicle ditch faced east, the wrong direction. In 1975, a new wall was constructed. Watchtowers were replaced with ones that didn't sway in high winds. Anti-vehicle obstacles were removed, and the anti-vehicle ditch was filled in because of the design of the new wall segments.
Von diesen Winkelementen sind insgesamt
45,000 of these segments were produced. Each one of these segments cost about $150.
59 Mark für die Grenzanlagen.
This new wall allowed the border guards to remove the anti-vehicle ditch. The new segments fulfilled the same function as the ditch barrier, because their anchored construction prevented vehicles from trying to ram through the wall. It would not topple. Each prefabricated segment was then smoothly joined together and often brightly painted by artists on the western side.
By now, the wall was something of a tourist attraction. A fact that helped save the lives of four escapees, one of whom was 3 months pregnant. A Western tourist filmed them swimming desperately across the Spree, the river that runs through the center of Berlin. The border guards in the patrol boat were powerless to shoot, for fear of hitting the Western tourists close by. Getting over the wall safely now required not just bravery, but also ingenuity. Ingo Bethke, on the left, escaped in the 1970s while working as a border guard. His younger brother Holger remained in the east. The brothers picked a spot where the wall divided a street, with West Berlin on one side and East Berlin on the other. With a friend, Holger in the east fired an arrow over the wall. On a West Berlin rooftop, Ingo was waiting to pick it up.
Ja, wir hatten praktisch Angelsehne um eine Sektflasche.
We had spooled the fishing line around a champagne bottle.
Und er hat so praktisch, also nicht er, sondern mein Kumpel hatte die.
And my friend held the bottle's neck.
Also ja, am Flaschenhals,
ja? Am Flaschenhals.
Am Flaschenhals und
hier. And I shot.
Und ich habe praktisch geschossen.
One end of the fishing line was attached to the arrow, and the other was here. It spooled off from the bottle, and we managed to cover a long distance with it.
Damit haben wir eben gute Reichweiten erzielt.
The fishing line was attached to a steel cable.
In dieses Stahlseil hatten wir dann so vorgefertigte
Rollen. We hung from the steel cable on small pulleys, which we had prepared beforehand. I went first, and 2 or 3 minutes later, my friend came after me.
Danach.
Ingo and Holger both escaped. In 1989, they prepared to rescue their youngest brother, Eki. This would be one of the last escapes, and one of the most ingenious and daring in the history of the war.
We already had our first ideas about how to get Eki out 5 years before we actually flew.
On the 23rd of May 1989, Ingo and Holger took off into the dawn sky of West Berlin at the controls of 2 microlight aircraft. Each plane carried a camera to record the adventure.
We all had walkie-talkies, but the problem was we couldn't get into contact. Maybe the distance was too great or there were too many obstacles between us. We simply weren't able to get a radio connection. I just had to be there each time, hoping they would come.
Eki's call sign was Hurdle Dirdle.
I heard the famous Hurdle Dirdle only when both of them were already in the air.
The wall lay ahead, East Berlin the other side.
They came over the trees. I was so excited and asked if I was meant to come out, but Ingo said, not yet.
While Ingo brought his plane into land, Holger circled.
I was so afraid the police would arrive, that someone had seen me or followed me. I was more nervous than Ingo. He kept his cool. It all happened so fast. We got over the trees okay. Holger had stayed up in the air, and now he flew behind us.
We
had never tried flying over a city before, just over forests. Finding your way around is really quite different. We knew we had to keep going along the wall, and there would be the Reichstag,
with a beautiful lawn in front.
The brothers were heading for the distinctive Reichstag, Germany's parliament building. The lawn surrounding it would be their landing strip. After just 16 minutes in the air, the flight was over. The rescue attempt had been a resounding success.
We landed at the Reichstag, and I was so happy. I got out of the plane, which wasn't actually more than a seat, a flying chair. I got down on my knees and kissed the ground and said, I don't believe it. We did it.
In 1989, the German Communist Party celebrated 40 years in power. Walter Ulbricht had been replaced by Erich Honecker as party leader. Honecker had been responsible for implementing Ulbricht's decision to build the wall. Now he declared it would last another 100 years.
I always thought the wall will not fall. I saw for myself how well it was made, how it was constantly being perfected. For me it was clear, Honecker was right. It will last another 100 years and longer.
But Hungary, one of East Germany's partners in communist Eastern Europe, was dismantling its Cold War barriers to the West. The Iron Curtain was at last beginning to come down. By the end of the 1980s, the communist states of Eastern Europe had had their day. Only East Germany didn't recognize that the world was rapidly changing. East Germans had always been able to travel to other Eastern Bloc communist states. Now they could go around the wall by traveling through Czechoslovakia, onto Hungary, and walking across what had become an open border to Austria, into the West, and freedom.
And East Germany then sealed its border with Czechoslovakia. It essentially isolated itself from the 20th century. And this emboldened the people who'd never been bold before. And the moment they started to think and act for themselves, the regime essentially was finished. The ultimate irony was that in a state run by total bureaucracy, it was a bureaucratic error that defeated it and destroyed it in the end. And the error came about like this. The East German head of government sensed that to head off the rising tide of dissent, he would open the wall to let people out, but this would be properly regulated. You'd have to go to a police station, get a visa stamp, permission. And he gave it to a man called Gunter Schabowski, who was a Politburo member, and said, at your nightly press conference, announce this. And Schabowski did not look at it because he was in a hurry. And at the end of the press conference, he said, oh, and by the way, there's some new travel regulations.
Also, Privatreisen nach dem Ausland können ohne vorliegen.
And he reeled them out that in future East Germans would be allowed to travel. And an Italian journalist said, when? And Schabowski said, oh. And he fumbled to look for this piece of paper he hadn't read and looked at it and said,
unverzüglich.
As far as I know, immediately.
This is a historic night. The East German government has now declared that East German citizens can pass through the wall beginning tomorrow morning, no restrictions.
Harald Jäger was in charge of the Bornholmer Strasse checkpoint. When he heard the news, he was eating his evening meal.
I almost choked on my food. I left the canteen to consult with my superior and to get him to explain to me what was going on and what precisely it would mean for us.
On the evening of the 9th of November 1989, East Berliners who'd watched the press conference live on television started to mass at the checkpoints, first in their tens, then in their hundreds, then in their thousands.
Mein damaliger Direktor, Vorgesetzter, rief mich dann nochmal an und sagte...
My superior called me once more and repeated that only those citizens who behave provocatively were allowed to leave.
Und das hieß dann konkret so?
Of course, these Germans who were there noticed that some people were being allowed to cross the border and others not, that we held some people back. For this reason, the situation got worse, and some people did become aggressive. That's when I decided to let my colleagues open the barrier and let everybody cross. Accordingly, the barriers were raised around 10:30, 10:15 p.m. No further controls were made, and East Germans literally flooded into West Berlin.
As East Berliners headed west, they started to dismantle the wall. The collapse of the wall was the death knell for the regime that had built it. For a while, the East German government maintained a ghostly half-life, stamping people's passports as they pass through into West Berlin. In less than a year, East Germany had disappeared altogether. Berliners from East and West gathered at the heart of their historic city to celebrate the unification of Germany. Officially, 239 people were killed trying to escape East Berlin. Parts of the death strip still remain. And almost all that's left of one of the most divisive constructions in history is the Border Guards patrol road, where today Berliners ride their bikes and walk their dogs.
Here we are, a decade and more on from the fall of the wall. There are still two distinct societies there. They're feeling a path towards each other. They're getting over 28 years of differences. Many in the East still defend the wall. They felt that they were trying to create socialism, to get rid of obscene riches, to take fear and poverty out of everybody's life. It was a wonderful ideal. They felt only having a wall would allow them to try it. And it went horribly, horribly wrong.
Next on Discovery, dramatic dogfights over the Atlantic Ocean in air wars, protecting the Allied convoys.